Thank you all for coming. Welcome to Cornell University's College of Architecture, Art, and Planning. I'm Bob Balder. I'm the executive director here. You won't see a lot of my students, unfortunately, in this evening's session. Unfortunately, they're going into the final week of all of their presentations, so they're going to have their heads down and be in the other end of the floor. Normally, I'd love to have them over here to kind of engage in this conversation, but right now is a pretty tough time. They've got a lot on their plates. But nonetheless, we're very happy that you joined us this evening, and wanted to at least go through a little piece of technology, because we are going to have some interactive time with your phone, and I want to make sure that if you go onto our server, everything is wireless here. You'll see what's called Red Rover. If you need to use our Wi-Fi, you're welcome to do it. It does mean that you need to register, and that will take a couple of minutes, and since we want to kick off with this interactive feature, if you do need it, we are 20 floors up. Some of you are probably getting a great signal. I have AT&T. Without plugging them, I do pretty well, but if you want to have the Wi-Fi here, go ahead and type in, just find Red Rover. It'll ask you just to be able to put in your identity, and then you can go ahead and submit, and then in a couple of minutes, you'll get a confirmation to make sure that you're in the system, okay? Pretty simple. After about 3 weeks, you'll probably get a notice saying you're terminated and that you don't have access to Cornell anymore, but certainly we can always renew if you're back in the house. So we're very excited to be the host for this fabulous now 6-week series, and we're excited to have some familiar faces in the crowd, some people that we know really well. So we're of course excited that Roland is with us, and I want to do a little brief intro for Roland, who's a lifelong New Yorker and, of course, is a Columbia University graduate, which I don't hold against him.
Other Ivy League school mistakes.
That's right, yeah, another one, even though we kind of feel like maybe we're the new guys on the block. But we do have some Cornellians in the house over here, as she is. Roberto knows.
Big Red.
We've got a few in there, Big Red. And, of course, he has a graduate degree in urban planning, but also a Juris Doctor, so he knows his way around the law. And of course, going back to 2007, took on the helm of the Waterfront Alliance, and of course, under his leadership, the profile and the impact of this organization has been quite profound, and we're looking forward to next week. I know that everyone's working hard. Jose is feverishly putting out some last-minute fires on the rest of the staff, but obviously next Thursday, everyone is going to be hopefully on the Hornblower out there, ready to participate. So without further ado, let me welcome Roland Lewis.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob.
Well, good evening. Thank you, Bob, and thank you, Cornell University, my adopted university. This is an amazing space. Columbia's got nothing like this, actually. We are 6 of 6 on our brand new deep dive series, which have worked out just famously well. We are so grateful for the space and for also our good sponsors here, Arcadis and AKR, who have generously donated funds to make this all possible. We're finishing with ferries, and I think it's one of the most important things. Actually, when I took this job, my first gig was there's a mural press conference on in Sunset Park. Go over there, and they put me up on the stage, and I knew a little bit enough, but I knew enough to take out my Metro card with Mayor Bloomberg next to me. Say, "Mr. Mayor, this is great, but we got to get the ferries taking this thing too." And I got a big round of applause. And we're not there yet, but we're getting there. And one of the things we've worked on since that day, about 9 years ago, was to increase ferry transit, to work with neighborhoods around the city to that are underserved and transit starved areas to create more transit options. Some folks, I see my friend Joe out there from the Rockaways, who have suffered through tremendous transit challenges, and there's others in the Bronx, all over the city, that where ferry transit is a solution. It's not the solution, but it is a solution for hundreds of thousands of New Yorkers. And the point of this session, and I applaud all of you for braving that clammy duck weather out there to come and join us, the point of this session is, I think, one of the most important points. I know I have confidence with the EDC and Hornblower that they will get the boats, they'll get the technical stuff right, they'll get the boats on time, beautiful new vessels. So that technical engineering stuff is probably going to be right. There'll be some tweaks about it, of course, as time goes on. But the most important thing is getting it to market, getting those communities to adopt a new way of understanding transit, to embrace this transit, and communicate from the city. So we will be partners in that, but we've brought together three different voices that are going to, I think, a person with great community organizing expertise that knows how to genuinely communicate back and forth to the community, the people who are marketing it, and the city who's working now, has been working with communities as they've created it, and led by, I'm proud to say, a former intern, now up at Columbia University. You know, it's going to lead these folks. So I will just also echo what Bob said before about our. If you haven't signed up yet for our conference, please do so. There's still room at the end. We are on the Hornblower Infinity, an amazing boat. We are the conference on a boat, and it is. We have. If you like the content here, you'll love it, the series of things that we have at the conference. So without further ado, I will ask Ina to come forward and introduce her stellar panel and get the show on the road. I'm sorry, are we ready for a Mentimeter? Yes, we are. What's that?
We're going to do it in the presentation.
We're going to do it in the presentation, so stay tuned. There's a thing called, you'll have your computer machines ready, at the ready, and Ina will tell you exactly what to do to get the Mentimeter operating. Okay, take it away, Ina. Big hand for Ina.
So, just before we get started, I want to mention this Mentimeter. So basically, you go to www.govote.at and enter the code 470028, and that will allow you to see the questions and submit your responses. Okay?
Can you say that for sure?
Yes, so it's www.govote.at, and the code is 470028.
Can you put the
address
in your mouth?
I'm sorry.
Okay, so the web address is www.govote.at, and the code, when it asks you to enter one, is 470028. Okay, so good evening, everyone. My name is Ina Guzenfeld, and I am a former Waterfront Alliance intern, and I'm thrilled to be here today for the final Deep Dives panel, focusing on a topic very close to my heart and yours, which is Citywide Ferry Service. And it's really thrilling to see community members represented here, including Coney Island and, of course, the Rockaways. So in February of last year, Mayor de Blasio announced a plan to bring ferry service to transit-starved communities along the East River, and that's what we call Citywide Ferry Service. Citywide Ferry Service represents the largest and most significant city-driven expansion of ferry service in New York's history. So I thought I would start by putting in context this idea of a municipal ferry system, which is what the city is in many ways looking to create or recreate with Citywide Ferry Service. So the history of ferries in New York, as we know, it really begins in the 19th century. And at the time, New York had a robust network of ferry routes, and these were all privately owned and operated, so by private ferry companies on the East River and railroad companies on the Hudson. And this network was in many ways responsible for not only creating fast connections to Manhattan, but spurring residential and commercial development in neighborhoods like Brooklyn Heights, Greenpoint, and Williamsburg. But by the turn of the century, New York ferries were in decline. The harbor was choked with traffic, and the city saw a need for new crossings that would take workers to new and more centrally located business districts in Manhattan. So one by one, bridges, subways, and tunnels replaced old ferry routes, and many ferry companies went out of business, unable to compete. However, there was still a need for ferry service, and so the city began to take over struggling routes. The first of these was the Staten Island Ferry, which is still owned by the city, and is in fact the longest continuously operating ferry route in New York history, and that was in 1905. And in the 1920s, under Mayor John Hyland, the city bought out a dozen routes on the East River and created the first city-owned ferry system. But unfortunately, the city couldn't save the ferries. And so they stopped providing service in the 1940s. And after the construction of the Verrazano Narrows Bridge, the last of these ferries ceased operation. So by the 1960s, ferries had all but disappeared from New York Harbor, both the East River and the Hudson. But what brought ferries back in the 1980s was, of course, real estate. So in 1986, Arthur Imperatore started service between Weehawken and Midtown, and soon new routes sprang up on both sides of Manhattan. At the time, under the Koch administration, the city agreed to provide infrastructure but not subsidies, and wasn't really interested in planning ferry service. But what we've seen in the last 10 years is a major reversal. The city has taken an active role in promoting ferry service, for example, with the East River Ferry, and that's really allowed ferries to grow again in New York City and multiply throughout the harbor. We have more access, we have new neighborhoods and waterfront destinations, and ferries play a key role in the city's economic development, including, of course, tourism, which is a major driver of our economy. And all of the city's efforts to date, in tandem, of course, with community activism, have been building towards citywide ferry service. So we are now at a very important juncture where extensive and affordable service is finally coming to communities from Bay Ridge to Soundview. But all of this is happening very quickly, on an accelerated schedule and an unprecedented scale. So there are many questions and concerns, and there's a major challenge, which is how can the city engage communities so that they support and sustain citywide ferry service for years to come? So that's what we're going to discuss today. And now without further ado, I'd like to introduce tonight's distinguished panelists. So we have James Wong, who is Vice President and Director of Ferries at the New York City Economic Development Corporation, which is the agency that manages real estate and citywide ferry service on behalf of the city. And he has been leading environmental review and public outreach for citywide ferry service. So if you attended one of the draft public scoping meetings last year, there are others also coming up this year, and you would have seen James. James is a transportation engineer and planner by training. Cameron Clark, who is Vice President and General Manager at Hornblower, New York. Hornblower has been selected as the operator for citywide ferry service. Cameron is also an engineer by training, and he has been with Hornblower for over 12 years. And last but not least, Lisa Cohen, who is the Principal Consultant at Hummingbird Consulting, and former board president of the Red Hook Initiative, where she served for 8 years, from 2005 to 2013. At that time, there were some major developments in ferry service for Red Hook, and of course, Hurricane Sandy. And Red Hook's response, in particular the response of Red Hook Initiative, earned the organization a number of awards. And so each speaker we'll now give a brief presentation followed by a facilitated discussion where you'll have the chance to ask questions of the panelists. Thank you.
Thanks, Ina. Thank you very much, everyone. As Ina said, I'm James Wong. We're doing a joint presentation tonight, Cam and myself, because of course we're in this boat together, as it were. That's the last of them that I could plan for. I don't know if the puns just happen naturally these days. So we're really excited at EDC because the citywide ferry service is furthering a lot of the mayor's primary goals here. The ability to support growing neighborhoods. This is one that's extremely important to EDC and its mission throughout everything that we're doing. In addition, looking at transit equity and ensuring that we have access to opportunity for these neighborhoods. So where there are places that do not have great transit access today, it's a really important aspect that we can provide for them, and we're really looking forward to that. In addition, ferries provide resiliency and redundancy to the transportation network, something that we have definitely seen the impact of, certainly in a post-Sandy scenario. Sorry, I'm just pulling this up. We had a couple of major project goals at the start of this and that we continue to keep in mind as we pursue this. The first and foremost is that we have a safe system. It's essential that everything that we do, whether we're working with our operator, with our designers, with other folks along the waterfront, of which there are many, it's really critical to us that we are making sure that safety is the first and most important element. We're also on an extremely fast timeline. We are looking forward to a launch next summer with the first route in the Rockaways. We're focused on creating a unified system with a real focus on the customer, making sure that there's a seamless transfer between all of the routes, ensuring that people feel like they're on the city's ferry service. And in addition, ensuring that the East River Ferry, with which we've had a lot of success, that EDC and the city have had a lot of success, will continue to thrive in the future system. So I want to give just a quick overview for anyone who doesn't know. So the Citywide Ferry System will be comprised of 6 routes. That's 3 routes that will be launching in 2017, including the Rockaways, South Brooklyn, and Astoria. In addition, we have 2 routes that will be launching in 2018. Those are the Lower East Side and the Soundview routes. In addition, we also have the East River Ferry, which is our current route, which is in the middle here. And that route is already currently operating and will be continued and integrated into Citywide Ferry Service. The full network is comprised of 21 landings throughout the city and its waterfront communities. These landings will be within half a mile of nearly 500,000 New Yorkers, and in addition, will be near 15,000 NYCHA units throughout the city. We're projecting 4.6 million trips per year along the system, something that we're really excited, and real growth off of the existing East River Ferry routes. In addition, and some of the biggest news that came as part of the initial announcement around this project was that we will be pegging our fare to the price of a standard bus or subway fare, so $2.75. This is a tremendous improvement. Certainly, it's less than what we charge on the East River Ferry today. We're looking forward in the future to integrating and bringing that price down, and also making this accessible to New Yorkers everywhere. This is one of the most important elements of the project to ensure that when we pursued this, that we understood that $2.75, the price of a bus or a subway, was very critical to being able to support the project. And lastly, one of the really great elements here is that the Citywide Ferry Service will be really comprised of something that's ADA and Local Law 68 compliant. So from the boats to the barges, the bathrooms, everything in between, we are keeping in mind that we need to provide a system that increases access for all New Yorkers. To give a brief implementation update, since we are moving quickly and folks have been rightly sort of curious about the amount of work that we've been doing here. On the outreach side, which is the subject that we'll get into a little bit more throughout the Q&A tonight, we have an open door briefing policy, which means, actually just quick raise of hands, who's had a Citywide Ferry briefing here? Has heard one of us speak? Okay, yeah, a few folks. So this is new, and Joe Hardigan in the back has heard us 23 times, so he counts for a few. But we do have an open door briefing policy. We've met with over 150 community groups and elected officials since the start of this project less than 2 years ago. So that's really a big number and something that we're really proud of, because we are going out and meeting with groups around the city, whether it's a community board, a civic organization, a parks organization. I mean, there are people literally around the city who have been hearing us give this speech and versions of it, and we're really excited about that. In addition, we have our environmental review process, which is underway. We just released our draft EIS, which was a big part of our work, and we're looking forward to having a final EIS sometime in July of this year. So we're still continuing to move very quickly and aggressively in order to make sure that we're going through all the really important steps as far as disclosure, but also making sure that we can move efficiently through the process and be ready for our launch next summer. Lastly, I want to update you on our infrastructure. We are actively building barges. The system is already under construction. We've got 6 barges that are currently under construction in Mays Shipyard out in Staten Island. And we've started our permitting process, so we work with the state and federal regulators to ensure that all of the work that we're doing on the barges and the landings are permittable. And so once those are complete, we'll be able to begin construction as early as the end of this year and the early part of next year. So as we get ready, we'll be bringing the landings to all of the different places and installing them. The last and perhaps most important part in very recent history is that we now have an operator. This is Hornblower. This is Terry McCray in the middle, the president of Hornblower, with the mayor and the best looking captain that we had on hand that day. Somebody who literally just looked like he has been on a boat forever. We're really excited to work with Hornblower, and that's where Cam is going to be working with us on. Hornblower has over a decade of experience in New York Harbor. They have over 400 local employees. They carry over 13 million trips a year in New York Harbor alone, exceeded only by the Staten Island Ferry, the biggest player in the market. They have a great international presence and a lot of experience. One of the most important things that I think was really compelling about Hornblower is that they actually have this specialized expertise in starting up systems and getting things up and running. And that's something that was extremely important to us. As we said, we're starting in 2017, and this is a project that was announced in the State of the City in 2015. So there's not a lot of time between when you decide to do something and get something up and running. So we're really excited to be able to move very quickly with Hornblower. There's a great new fleet that's coming with this project. I'll let Cam talk about that a bit more. We know that they're going to be paying excellent wages, so we are very confident in all the workforce development that happens as part of Hornblower's work. And of course, having industry recognition both in safety and in their environmental records, having a long-standing commitment to sustainability and ensuring the positive impact on our waters. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Cam to talk a little bit more about what Hornblower is doing and also to focus a little bit about how we're going to get people on the boats themselves.
Okay. Hi there, how's everybody doing this evening? Still some energy at the end of the day. That's fantastic. So, James, so thank you so very much for the kind introduction. Ina, appreciate it as well. And we're truly honored to be here, to be a part of this conversation, to be able to be standing here, and really, as you mentioned, Ina, following in the footsteps of so many great people that really set this stage for this opportunity. Going all the way back, I think, to the Vanderbilts and Robert Fulton with the first steamboat carrying people here. In New York, and we're honored to be able to help carry that vision forward that Roland Lewis was talking about, even earlier on when he first got engaged in Waterfront Alliance. I just want to spend one moment here before going forward. I think one of the important things from Hornblower's perspective and why we are excited to be able to participate in this, and I think you'll see over time, I'm sure at the end of this, you're going to be saying, gosh, we want more information, we want more, and we will give you more as the time allows. We are still working proactively with EDC, with the city, to get things finalized and to be able to then communicate a full detailed plan. And then we're going to show you, as we'll talk a bit here this evening a little bit, where you'll be able to go to get that information, how you can stay engaged, how you can get involved, be part of the conversation. And I think one of the things that's allowed Hornblower to grow into the organization that we are is our entrepreneurial spirit. Our owner started the company with one vessel in Berkeley, California, just over 35 years ago, and we now are a business of nearly a few thousand employees operating in locations across the country, some internationally, and we have specialized in coming into markets where ridership is underserved or systems aren't fully recognized, or people are looking for the balance between ridership and hospitality. Our roots started in hospitality, and we've taken that and transferred it into the public sector, saying, why can't you get from A to B and do it in a positive, helpful, friendly, courteous, safe manner? And so I think those are all the things that have allowed us to get to the point where we're at today. And I do just want to mention around the environmental, customer service, and safety, one of the things Hornblower through Alcatraz Cruises Services back in 2006 became the first service company in the United States to have an integrated management system around the foundations of ISO 14001, which is an environmental standard, and ISO 9001, which is a quality standard, and an OSIS 18001 health and safety standard. We believe in the concept of continual improvement, not saying we do everything perfectly, but trying to put things in place so we can have a plan, do, check, act culture, which engages both the community and then our internal crew members. So moving forward and talking a little bit about it, we're excited to help New Yorkers work, live, play, and making commuting and connecting in New York even easier than it is today. We've recently held a series of focus groups where we brought in New Yorkers who have been here from 2 years to who have lived here their entire life at 54 years. And part of the stuff that we're working on right now to develop the final programs, the rollout, the marketing, the amenities on board, are tied to the feedback that we are getting from these focus groups. It was enlightening for us to understand what people's true wants and desires are, from on time to reliability, to then the accoutrements that people I think are becoming to expect as things are evolving. A system that's integrated and connected. One of the things that's important to us that we've learned, we have a plan in place to deliver it, but is connecting to upland transit. So partnering and having a network of open architecture within your reservation system. So you can learn about it through City Mapper, through Transit Link, through Moovable or other systems. I'm sure there's a question that'll be out there, so I'll answer it in advance. Well, what about transfers to MTA, buses and subways? So, well, we want to work towards that. We understand it's different agencies, but we believe as being Switzerland here, we will be able to work with the city, we will be able to work with MTA, and our goal would be able to support the riders, both the local New Yorkers or the out-of-town visitors, in a seamless transition at some time in the future. So we're looking forward for people to start riding with us in the summer of 2017. This is a working name, Citywide Ferry, but it is right now the location that you all can go to, citywideferry.nyc, to get more information about us, about the service, about the system, about the routes, and you can sign up to get a free annual pass on the ferry when it launches. So make sure to do that, share with your friends as well, because even at the great value of $275, being able to get on and have that free pass, I think is something to be pretty darn exciting. So it's something that will run year-round. Our boats are being designed to be able to run in inclement weather. Slush in the river from the ice are being designed to not impact the vessel's ability to operate. Instead of raw water systems, we have keel coolers. The bow stem on the vessel is reinforced with an ice belt. We have above waterline dry exhaust systems so we can ensure that throughout the season, inclement weather, we're able to stay in service. Ride control on the vessels. Passive systems in the river vessels and active systems on the rockaway vessels. And by active, it means it's dynamic and changing to the changing water and river and ocean conditions. In addition to that, it is flexibility. We believe that amenities is important not only on the vessels, but how do you learn about the system? How do you get access to the system? How do you interact with the system? It has to be easy. We all walk around with these today. I'd like to see a show of hand who doesn't have a phone, a mobile phone. Not one person. So people will get access to information from these devices, updates. We are going to do our darndest to make sure that we're timely, that we're reliable. But when we're not, we want to make sure we can communicate that to you so you can plan your trips accordingly. So in terms of the mobile ticketing technology, we believe it is a critical component to the system. We can show up with great boats that have a great level of service, but if it's not easy to learn about, not easy to schedule your day or plan your trips, it won't be as successful as it could be. And I think that's one of the things that we're proud about here with the system that we're looking to bring forward. A few other things as well. Bicycles, we know that's a big thing, and we look forward to also working with City Bike and Motivate to ensure that we've got great connections in place for those who are riding City Bike and thinking of that green connection, car-free, from start of trip to end of trip. How do we make sure that you know how to utilize that connection and integrate it into the system with us as well? Wanted to talk just a little bit about the vessels. This isn't the only vessel. We have two designs of vessels, one dedicated to the river service and one dedicated to the rockaway service. What we are showing here is a river service vessel. The rockaway service vessel is slightly different. But we believe in the Airbus model. We have the Airbus 320A and the Airbus 320B. We don't want them so different that you're getting on board and Yeah. It feels like a totally different vibe and different vessel. So one is scaled up from the other. Hornblower has worked diligently with the city. We didn't take this out to bid to one entity, but to over a dozen different shipyards. We've received feedback from 10 of them, and we've been working diligently to narrow that field down. And I anticipate here in the very soon weeks ahead that we'll be able to announce to everybody the decision, where we're heading, the timelines of when things will be rolling out. We're working with a world-class designer in Cat Crowther, one of the top designers in the world, to develop the best vessel that we can. By best, I mean we understand and accept the fact that we still are burning diesel. While Hornblower has a tremendous track record with environmental technologies from hybrid propulsion systems, battery system designs, we're working with Marriott and the Coast Guard on hydrogen fuel cells. To date, we are still burning diesel. So our goal is to reduce the most we can. We have the most haul efficient forms that MCAT Crowther was able to design for us to reduce the wake wash energy that would potentially impact the shoreline, kayakers, paddleboarders, swimmers. We have 360 degree views of the vessel, not only for the passengers on board, but for the crew, the captain as well. Cameras around the entire vessel. So if there are people in the water, the captain can be aware and see those things. The cameras also have infrared capabilities, so it's not just daytime, but these vessels will be running into the evening, nighttime as well. LED screens on board. Most people think of LED screens as purely entertainment, but it's also for communication. Geofence systems set up on board the vessels, so when you're coming into the dock, it's letting you know we're coming into the dock, hold on to handrails. And why not just over the loudspeakers? Some people can't hear, and so the visual screens will be able to communicate that to people. Audio plugins throughout the vessel, so if you are hearing impaired, you can sit down, plug in, and actually listen to the system that's coming on throughout. Stroller parking, wheelchair parking, and as James said, Local Law 68 compliant, and I think I could actually say beyond in many instances to the extent that we truly could. Not going through all these, but gosh, there's a plethora of amenities that we feel people may want. Everything from Wi-Fi to a cup of coffee to some of the longer routes. It is that chance to, one of the women from the focus group said, get her party started for the end of a work week. But we understand that there's different things that people would want. I think the most important is we want clean, we want convenient, and we want to make sure that it's flexible, dynamic, and reliable to meet our riders' needs, both commuters, as well as those who are going to be going out to the Rockaways to go surfing in the summer or picnic and visit friends, and that kind of New York staycation we see with a system like this will provide that that opportunity. So all I can recommend to you all right now is to go to the website, check it out, citywideferry.nyc. There's a 2-minute survey. We'd love to get your feedback. I think it will help us in our planning. We don't see this being a static system. We don't see what we come forth with day one being the final solution. I promise you that EDC has felt it from us already. We will charge and push ourselves and our partners in the community to improve the system over time, to make the system better over time. But we can start today with your feedback. And by just taking the time to have that, you could also be entered in that opportunity to, as I say, win that free annual pass. Additionally, what you'll see coming up shortly on that Citywide Ferry site right now is our Hornblower Happenings. It's a blog that talks about things going on within the community, things that we're doing. I think there's even a post up there about the deep dive here with Waterfront Alliance this evening, as well as some of the other stuff we have going on. And this will be a portal that you'll all be able to go to see live video of the vessels being constructed, updates on our progress as we get into the construction phase, as well as, we believe, an opportunity to meet some of the faces that make up the Hornblower family. We're a large group, but we have people that diverse, great stories that have helped us get to this point, who are going to be helping be a part of this project. One of the people on our marketing team, while I'm not a Cornell alum, he is a Cornell alum, and he's proud of his history here. And I could see us at one time here. He was helping us with our branding and all right now. It'd be a great story to talk about him. So. Staying up to date is critical, and we think that this portal that you'll be able to have access to through Citywide Ferry will be that information portal for you to stay engaged, to see what's going on. And it's a two-way conversation. It's not shown here, but you can leave comments, ask questions, and we do have an active team that would support getting back to you on that. So Again, I've taken up probably enough of your time, but I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. Excited to, you know, be here with all these great panelists and talking more about ferries in New York and how it's going to continue to help people change their lives for the better. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Lisa. I know almost nothing about ferries and very little about PowerPoint, so you're really in for a treat. I work with the Red Hook Initiative, which is a youth-serving organization in Red Hook, Brooklyn. And Red Hook is a waterfront community, has the second biggest NYCHA development in the state in the center of Red Hook, and then a fair amount of business and a gentrifying neighborhoods around the outside. We work with young adults who live in the Red Hook houses, and then the adults in their lives. We serve about 400 kids a year. And importantly, I won't read the PowerPoint to you, but 95% of our staff are from Red Hook, so we're also an economic engine for the neighborhood. All of which may make you wonder why I am here tonight. We have been, since our founding, we've been a source for outside institutions and researchers from outside the neighborhood who are seeking to learn more about Red Hook. That phenomena was always the case, but it increased exponentially after Hurricane Sandy. Academics, students, government agencies, nonprofit intermediaries, foundations, real estate developers, and a world of consultants have come through the neighborhood to try to understand the impact of the storm and the ways that Red Hook has recovered or not. Some folks want to document, some to plan, some to build or bring new resources into the neighborhood, and others to develop plans to address ongoing needs in Red Hook and other low-lying communities. Most of these plans have included some form of community engagement. The residents of Red Hook and the organizations that serve them have been focus grouped, surveyed, interviewed, filmed, studied, and planned for over and over again. And a conservative estimate of over 50 asset mapping workshops and community meetings have taken place. And it's really exciting that there is this interest in the neighborhood, that people want to bring resources in. But also, community engagement is a very vague term, and people mean all kinds of different things with it. We try to be really clear about who we work with and who we can generate conversations with. But this was not really, we never planned on having this be such a big sort of part of our business. And so we have really been struggling with how to facilitate community engagement in a way that is useful, and that is really a meaningful experience both for the residents who are being engaged and that helps to bring in new resources. So now's when we're gonna try our fancy, what's it called? Infometrics, Mentimeter. So the question is about why community engagement is important in planning processes. You can be typing your answers in now, I think. Will they pop up if people put them in while we talk? So local knowledge is invaluable. I thought Jane Jacobs' birthday was yesterday, but we'll take her birthday week. To reflect as many opinions as possible about city priorities. It's effective when it's done well. I mean, I think people want all kinds of different things from community engagement, and I think it's really, I mean, where we come from is that it's, we think it's critical that people who are going to be impacted have a voice in how things come down. And it's a lot easier said than done. So can I go back to, so I just want to tell you why this conversation is relevant, or sort of what our goals are as a youth-serving organization. Being a part of this conversation. So this is just like the things that off the top of my head, processes in the neighborhood that have gone down in the last 18 months. NYCHA has come in to talk about their temporary boilers, the resiliency rebuild, Section 3 jobs. New York Rising has had a team in Red Hook talking about neighborhood priorities for the rebuild. There's a, they've been asking local residents to adopt a storm drain. I don't really know how that's going. It's like not a cute puppy or anything, but. There's a microgrid in Red Hook that has been in development. There's actually two microgrids in Red Hook that have been in development. The EDC is working on this integrated flood protection system. Since Litch closed, there have been a ton of conversations about what health services were available to the neighborhood. What's under the Litch closing? There's something else there, I think. Anyway, our ball fields are toxic. There's mold in the houses. We have a lot of people participating in participatory budgeting. Municipal IDs got worked out. There was a meeting about where the city bike sites should be in Red Hook. The meeting to decide where they should be in Red Hook took place at the Carroll Gardens Library. There's a go on a Superfund. Anyway, you get the idea. There's a lot of these conversations. Each of them are super important. And if you're deciding what to do with your week, how do you choose which meeting to go to? And that's the question that a lot of our residents have been facing. Our goals as an organization for community engagement, well, our goal is to lay out a proactive definition of community engagement, one that we can get behind and that we can support. And then to develop a process or framework that captures authentic resident opinion and experience. And importantly, to discourage and to not contribute to a process that we feel like is just checking the box. And that can happen a bunch of different ways. There can be a mandate in a federal RFP that you engage the community. You can, for your Columbia journalism paper, have to go into a neighborhood and interview a resident. From top to bottom, there's a lot of different reasons that people are looking to engage the community. None of them malicious, but many of them not that well thought through. And then one thing that we've really been thinking about is how can folks be learning from each other? You know, after our 30th focus group, you think, wouldn't this have been a better use of everybody's time to read the report from the first one? So that's another. That's a little bit outside of our control, but it's something we've been thinking about. These are just some of the requests that come in. People looking to understand the lived experience of people in the neighborhood, people looking for low-income minority youth opinion, and then for resident opinions. And just a moment, and some of this is intuitive, but what the potential risks and benefits are, the way we think about it, when we ask people to come out on a weekday night to leave their kids at home, or to give up their favorite TV show, whatever, to come to a meeting, what's in it for them? The benefits, clearly, most important, are influence on an outcome that will either make their lives better or the neighborhoods better. The ferry systems are a boon for New York City. There's no question about that. To generate the data to support those services, to be heard, to have a voice in how services for you are being designed, to meet people from outside Red Hook, to raise your own profile or reputation, or we'll take raising the profile of Red Hook Initiative, that's fine too. And the same for compensation, to be paid for your time. The risks are also significant. One is about this sort of research fatigue, which is something that we've started to talk about. Aggravating or re-stimulating trauma, that's happened in particular around a lot of the hurricane questions. You're asking people to relive a really hard time, and doing that over and over again is a drag, particularly if you don't know why you're doing it. Exploiting the individual or community in the final presentation, or maybe less, or just interpreting them inaccurately, making false promises or overpromises about what the experience will generate, or just having nothing come out of it. And it may be that nothing comes out of it, or it may just be that we never learn what comes out of it. Both of those, I would say, are problems. So we've come up with these sort of non-negotiables, processes that we would feel good about putting out there for people to participate in. They must be valued and feel valued. There has to be appropriate context provided, so they have to just understand why this focus group, where's this information going, who's doing it, what else are they doing. We want to hear back as to what happens with our voices, with our information. The group is representative and not the same old voices, and that's hard because somebody coming into the neighborhood doesn't know who the same old voices are. They don't know that this particular person has been in the last 50 groups, or they don't know that this particular person, they found the only Republican living in Red Hook East, or whatever it is. You just need to put a little, I think there might be more than one. Maybe not. The project has to have a realistic and doable scope. And we have to feel like it's an authentic, back to the sort of checking a box thing, like a real, people really need the community's input for a good reason. And then, as I said, we'd also like it if entities would be able to learn from each other, And we don't know what that means, if there's some kind of a database. We've been talking to the Red Hook Library. They're devoting a shelf to reports and studies that have been done on Red Hook, which we think maybe can be like sort of the first step for people coming in. I took an online course with Livable City about collective impact. I'm not that good with an online course, it turns out. But I did think that this was like a really useful way of sorting out. Like I said, there's a lot of different things people look for in community engagement. It's not that some are better than others, but they're very different from each other. And I think it is important to be clear. Are you trying to inform the neighborhood? Are you trying to get their opinions on what flavor Yoo-hoo they like best? Are you trying to involve them in gathering information about Yoo-hoo from all of their neighborhoods? Do they still make Yoo-hoo? Is that a thing?
Yes.
Okay. Are they going to be partners in the process, or are they going to actually have final decision making? Right. There's a lot of different ways to go about this. My brilliant conclusion is that this is hard. I have a lot more sort of cautions about what not to do than I have guidance about what to do. Everybody has a lot of demands on them. You went to 150 community board meetings and meetings with politicians. Like, that's crazy. Now I'm going to tell you have to come to 15 more meetings in Red Hook. You know, like that, and there's only so much money to fund staff to do this or to give incentives or focus groups or whatever it is. We're all trying to do a lot at the same time. And there's not always a clear path. Sometimes you have a focus group and you walk away and what do you know, that someone wants a beer on the ferry? What do you do with that piece of information? You know, like, it doesn't always suggest what to do. And then the community is not monolithic. There are a lot of different voices in the community. And once you ask someone for their opinion, they expect you to do something with it. So you are opening up a set of expectations by engaging. So just a few suggestions. The first and I think most important is to be clear about what it is that you want out of this. And to be clear about what you're offering. And then people can make the decision about whether or not to participate. Second is to really learn about the community, learn about the neighborhood before you go in. Both sort of what are the conversations that are live at the moment, what's the history, what's the geography, what are the ethnicities, what are the neighborhood politics. It'll make for a much better use of your time and the people that you're talking to. And then as much as you can, go in with a flexible process and know that things almost never go down in the amount of time you think they're going to take, and that you don't usually get the answer. If you're doing it right, you don't get the answers you were expecting. So those are just some of our thoughts about this work from the community side. Again, it's just like one organization at one moment in time, but it's a conversation that we're really interested in having.
Been doing our talks tonight, and we have this very important question here that I think goes very much to the heart of what Lisa was talking about, which is this idea that community engagement is not something that should be taken for granted, and exploring why it's important in the planning process is essential to creating a good community engagement process. So we've said that local knowledge is valuable, and it's important to reflect a range of opinions, but it's also important to allow residents a chance to speak their opinions. And I think that's so vital with Citywide Ferry Service, because they're not just residents, they're also riders, and that's really, really powerful. The idea that resources are limited, and those resources are people's money, but also people's time. I'd like to maybe engage some of you on this issue of how you envisioned community engagement from the start in this process, and what were the principles that guided for Hornblower and for EDC that vision?
Sure. So let me wind back a little bit. I started at EDC just about 2 years ago, which is just on the heels of the end of the 2013 Citywide Ferry Study. The math doesn't add up because it took us a little while to finish publishing it. But in that study, we did a decent job with the outreach, I would say. It was, and this is my understanding because I wasn't there when it was actually done, there was elected outreach, there were some meetings with a couple of different civic groups, but this was a citywide study. We were looking at 60 sites around the city. Nobody knew if this was going to get picked up, and a planning process had ensued, and we did what we could within the time frame. And I think that from a very academic sense, we did a really good job of understanding things like ridership demand and those the more technical elements, and how many boats would you need if you wanted to run this kind of service. But when we started and actually started transitioning towards something that was much more of a project, once the city hall was at a point where they're saying, not only do we love the idea of pursuing ferry service, but wanting to do it at a grand scale, which is something that was really unprecedented, it became immediately important that as we start making the decisions that are more hyper-locally intensive, that we get out and engage the community. Now, EDC has a lot of projects. We actually have a governing community relations team that has one person for each borough and a couple of other folks who sort of float around. We have a specific person who is dedicated to outreach for this project. It's one of the things that, having come more recently out of planning school myself, I thought it was really important that we start getting out in the communities and having these conversations. We don't have to try and bake something and then hand it out. We don't have to build something in a vacuum. It was really about going out. So some of the first outreach was to the Astoria community, which already had some momentum on past work about whether we go on the north side of the peninsula or the south side. And I have a long list of other places where the engagement has actually resulted in tangible output. And I think that that's where we learned that it's, if you ask some project folks, they'll say like, oh, we do community engagement just, to check a box, as you had said. But I think we've had so many tangible changes that have come into this project for that sake. I'm just going to run through a very brief list because I think it's important. Having spoken with the human-powered vessels in the kayaking community, a specific workshop just to engage and understand at each landing location, where do we have to be cautious that a vessel backing out is going to be in conflict with kayakers? How do we know that horns are important? How do we know that the wake in this area could really cause an issue, and so let's turn a landing. We've made design changes. The idea that Long Island City is going to be, that we're looking at places that are not just where we think development's going to go, but where there's parks and where there's people, where there's stuff. In Red Hook itself, a very clear example of listening to the community and going forth and reacting through this process, that what we thought about doing was not what the community wanted, and then going back and creating those opportunities. So there's a lot more, but I think that it's important to highlight that really from early on in that process, and since then, we've really tried to do our best to engage in as meaningful a way as possible, certainly with all the limitations that, at least I think you're spot on highlighting.
Cameron?
I just say from a couple different points on that as it relates to engaging within the community. So, I think first and foremost, when you look at the system, I think for us, you must start, right? And once you start, you also then have to be flexible and have a willingness to change. And it sounds easy to do that, but it's almost against the law of physics change, right? It's resistance and good change or bad change, and everybody struggles with change. And an organization is no different, a community is no different, but if you have an operator that's in there that is saying, hey, despite those challenges, we'll be willing to listen to feedback, we'll be willing to engage the community and then be willing to change, I think that is a big priority. I think you learn a lot about the communities, not at community board meetings, but actually by engaging with people within the community. I think that's part of our culture. Within Hornblower, we have an outreach program, a volunteer program, all hands on deck. Crew members who are part of our organization have participated with events with New York Harbor School, the Billion Oyster Project, some of the other maritime academies here locally. And I think you learn a lot in more casual settings as opposed to formal settings about what people's needs are, about what the community's needs are. And I think that is part of the culture that we think will help us. For the needs in the Rockaway are going to be different than the needs in the Bronx versus Long Island versus Brooklyn or Red Hook. And so by not just thinking that it's a one-size-shoe-fits-all, New York is a great place, it's a diverse place, And I think to be able to do that is why you've been at 150 plus community board meetings and why we see the opportunity to engage with the community at different levels and in different ways is going to be important for us to create a system that's dynamic and evolving, hopefully for the better. So that's it from our perspective.
I think for Lisa, those of you who may not know, 20 years ago, Red Hook put out a nationally hailed community-based plan. And in that plan, ferry service was mentioned. So in fact, communities in New York City have been engaging with the City of New York about ferry service much longer than the City of New York has been engaging communities on that same topic. And what I want to ask Lisa is actually, is someone made this great point that community engagement helps build a sense of ownership toward a project. So how can the Red Hook community or any community where people are deeply concerned about not being left out take ownership of such a large project like Citywide Ferry Service?
I mean, just off the top of my head, I think that some of it is about asking them the questions that are relevant to their specific neighborhood, to their locality, to their commute, to their kids. And that those are the things that they're going to care the most about, and those are the things that they're going to be able to offer the most value on. It's actually almost impossible for a kid from Red Hook to go to Harbor School right now. Like, they have to get out of Red Hook. The F train doesn't go to Borough Hall, right? They have to get the 61 to Borough Hall to get the ferry from Manhattan. So, you know, that, like, if there's a conversation you could have about, like, kind of a local school and what would be helpful to you in getting there. I know we're not running a ferry to Harbor School, but I think this is the kind of thing, I mean, like, making sure that your questions have some currency with the people who you're talking to.
Lisa, we do run a ferry to Harbor School.
There we go. Can you run one from Red Hook to Harbor School? That would be super helpful.
Okay, so the $64,000 question is, for all of us, how often we would actually commute by ferry. And it seems like a fair number would say that often or always. So over 50% of the audience would say that they would commute very often by ferry if given the opportunity. I want to ask about kind of our combined experience with buy-in when it comes to ferry ridership. What barriers have you seen to ferry ridership, and how will Citywide Ferry Service decrease those barriers for those 600,000 residents who live near the waterfront?
I think one of the barriers that we're very excited to be able to break down is one that's economic. It costs $4 on the weekday and $6 on the weekend to ride the East River Ferry. If you are able to handle that and live either along the waterfront and connects and need to go to Midtown or Lower Manhattan, that's great. But it's not an option that's available to everyone. And so $275 being one of the sort of foundational elements is something that we were really excited about. And, you know, even when I first started the project, we didn't start at $275. If you look at that report, it looks at a variety of prices. Thanks to the administration of saying that that's where we're going to go, I think that's really important. And as we did that, and as we spent more time in the communities, it was really, really interesting to watch people's eyes kind of light up and they say, wait, I'm sorry, how much is it? When you go out to the Rockaways today, the American Princess, you take a boat out there, it costs $20, $30 a round trip to go out there for the day. So everyone thinks of it as this, luxury item, but what we've done and what I think is really important here is try to make it as accessible as the subway. So.
Is it all right if I ask a question to the audience real fast? Is that by show of hands for the folks who are often and always? Is that who? Raise your hand if it's for work, often and always for work. By show of hands, then for social. I think that's really interesting, right? So I mean, I think one of the things about the system is that a lot of the times the New Yorkers, and that's why that we live with work, live, play. New Yorkers really work to live and then play. And I think one of the importances then to be able to do that is have a system. Price is a critical piece, but then we feel that the reliability is to that next step is an even more critical piece. Really, as it ties to, see you here in just 1 second here, but it is really tied to the fact that people will make their choices of the meetings that they have set, the social engagements that they're planning with their friends or their family. And if we can't deliver an on-time, regular, reliable service, you're going to choose other options. One of the things New York does not have a shortage for, no shortage of choices in restaurants and no shortage of choices in transportation options in many areas. Now, I think where the ferries are going, we're going to help fix places that are underserved, but if it's not reliable, it won't matter. So I think the price is spot on, and you're right. We've heard that feedback too. One of our critical things for our crew and team is the on-time reliable aspects we think is going to help drive that up as well. So, yeah. It's now time for questions. Maybe I
any questions?
Should we hold questions?
Yes,
I think we're holding questions for just a
few. I kind of broke them while I apologize. I think we're holding questions the whole till the end. I apologize.
So for those who do live near the waterfront or have access to ferry service or hope to, we wanted to get a sense of what would be the most frequently used ferry landing. And this is actually interesting because I think what EDC has found is that once you provide this kind of loop ferry route, all kinds of interesting connections emerge. So the Dumbo stop, I think, is the most popular one for the East River Ferry because that's your access to Brooklyn Bridge Park. So I think for a lot of people here, it does skew, I think, toward Manhattan. So Pier 11, Fulton Ferry Landing as well in Brooklyn. Some of the, I think, more traditional connections to, you know, to Manhattan that we are trying to reestablish. So my question here is, you know, what about the places that want ferry landings but aren't really, you know, aren't necessarily part of this plan? I know that residents on the South Shore of Staten Island who have the longest commutes in the city have really been advocating ferry servicing and kind of hoped that something would come out of that temporary post Sandy service that was set up.
Sure, I mean, I guess to respond specifically to that and to folks, you know, we love ferries at EDC, and we know that they have tremendous power to connect these communities. Where it works terrific, especially in a harbor that doesn't freeze over in the winter, that gives you, except for a couple of days when you get really bad ice, we're in a pretty good shape to run pretty much all the time, and Cam will attest to how great we're going to do on the reliability. But ferries, I mean, one of the things that we recognize is that ferries don't work in all scenarios. They're not the solution to solve all problems. I certainly am well aware that there are transportation problems throughout the city. We know that, and we can't solve them with ferries in all situations. So one of the things, for example, that we know is that in certain neighborhoods, there is going to be less demand. Sometimes there's going to be a longer haul distance. And sometimes we look at all the different factors that go into ferry planning, which is where do people live, where do they work, how many people have transit alternatives today, what are the price points that they would be willing to pay for something when you fix it at 275, that's better. But we understand those dynamics and also understand that there are different sort of ways to find ways to serve these communities. So I guess broadly what I'm saying at this point is we certainly have an exciting plan to proceed here. It does not preclude the future of whatever we're going to do. So we'd like to get this system up and running, as Cam has been saying. We need to sort of give it a try, see what we can get, see how well this works. We think it's going to be very, very successful. But in going forward from there, who knows? If ferries are fantastic for the city and we need to double down on everything, you know, we'll see what happens, and the next set of plans sort of open the next world of opportunities for us.
So I actually wanted to return to the Red Hook angle and what happened with the Atlantic Basin, which I think is a great story and a great example of a community that often feels like it's not heard by government being heard, in this case by EDC. So my question, and I guess this is now for everyone, is what's the possibility that there will be some flexibility in these services once they're started up?
What opportunity is there for residents to say, well, actually, this stop doesn't work. Can you move it, you know, to a different stop in our neighborhood?
Sure. So, I mean, just to get started, we don't want to set the expectation that these are sort of, you know, just quick up and move these things around. This is major infrastructure. There's millions of dollars going into these projects. And so it's not sort of like on a whim to move something. And so we take very seriously and we think very, very carefully about how we place these landings. And when I was talking about these sort of very micro, hyper-local decisions, one of them is exactly what we're talking about, landing placement. I guess to give a little background on what's going on in Red Hook for those who don't know, when we did the Citywide Ferry study, we were looking at a landing that was already in existence. Some of you may know there's a landing right in front of the fairway. And the conventional wisdom at the time as a sort of planning exercise was, great, there's a landing in Red Hook. Red Hook gets on the map and we'll keep going and we'll move on from there. And that was great. We were going to look at finding ways to serve Red Hook with a ferry. And then as the plan continued to develop, it's really interesting because now we're getting to an implementation phase. We realize we need a landing that's more robust than that. We need a landing that serves two vessels at a time, that has much more amenities, is compliant with ADA and local law 68. So there's many reasons why we need to build a landing. And as we do that, we start realizing, okay, well, we have to be a little further in the depth of the water because of a couple of other factors. Everything happens and we end up with two options. One at the end of Van Brunt Street, which is a commercial corridor in Red Hook, and the other one is in a small park called Valentino Park. And the small park was one that the city controls. The city owns the parkland. We did not own the land where the landing had been proposed. And this is where we went into a scoping hearing in Brooklyn and we learned some very quick lessons. This is where we realized that inadvertently there was an overlapping planning process that had not made its way and intersected into what we were doing. The community was extremely vocal in telling us that they wanted a landing and they wanted it to be at a place called Atlantic Basin, which is nearby but not specifically where we had proposed it. And they also were telling us that this park is the treasure of the community and we could not go and take it over and use it for this purpose. And that the landing that we had proposed was, you know, two football fields down and how can we propose that? So we learned these very quick lessons, and in fact, this is, I say it like this, and I'm pretty candid about it because I'm really excited about how the process worked. We went through the environmental review process. The scope said we're looking at two places, and now we just released a draft EIS which reflects the impact of the comments on that scope and includes now four options for us to go both to Atlantic Basin, and we're also looking at a place called Erie Basin near IKEA. So the story goes that the city says, let's go to one of these two places. The community says, you didn't realize that we had planned for this third location that you didn't even bring up. And so the city now says, okay, great. Let's look at that and one more location as well, because we now have this full view of what the community provided. Of course, we would have liked to have gotten that earlier. Of course, we've learned some quick lessons. But now we're in a position with the community, which I think is much better, where we have an environmental document that talks about these realistic options and puts it in so that we can sort of move from there. So that's the background of the story. And I really do think that it's a success story out of what could have been a little bit of a tough spot.
Well, just to, yeah. I mean, I was not monitoring that particular controversy as it went on. There had, the year before, been a big fight in that park about the renovations of the bathrooms,
sure,
of the park.
Yeah.
So, I mean, one thing about Red Hook, like many New York neighborhoods, is we will fight about anything. But, so the Atlantic Basin stop is the one that's the furthest from the Red Hook houses, so I have no doubt that the community was loud in their request of you, but who was that community then? You know, I mean, it was, you hear from the people who care the most, and maybe that's right, but maybe there are people who don't even know the conversation's going on, too. So.
Yeah, and well, I think that's a really good point. The sort of evolution, and certainly following those scoping, so the scoping hearings are a very bureaucratic public process where you get up, you have 2 minutes to talk, and the city is not even allowed to sort of respond at that point. If we don't, we were gonna write it down and get back to you with a response. It's a very bureaucratic sounding, and the least sort of engaging of involvement. But like I said, we go to all these other meetings, and so in short order after that, a meeting with New York Rising and Red Hook, which is the Red Hook version of New York Rising to utilize state money and see what we can do from a resiliency purpose perspective, going to that kind of meeting, going and meeting with both Red Hook houses, East and West, and getting the feedback there. So it's really interesting because those are, I think you're right, some of the better opportunities to get a little bit closer. It's not as formal a setting. We have a pretty good, 15-20 minute pitch that we could go through and then sort of open it up to questions. And that's where we sort of get better exchange. But, you know, best you can do in the sort of scale that we're doing. So I think that we're doing all right. Hey, good job. We'll call it a solid good.
So I want to take our final digital question so that we can open it up to a Q&A. And this is a question that means different things, I think, to the public and to the city and to the operator, which is what matters most in maximizing the possibility of citywide ferry? Whether it's ridership, it's fare integration, transit connectivity. So I just kind of want to pose this as an open-ended question, and I want to add sustainability to possibility, because what we're seeing now is really a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, and how can we make sure that it doesn't go the way of a ferry experiments in New York in the past?
Do you want to run sustainability?
Sure.
Go from there.
Sure. Yeah, so I mean, I think sustainability, it's a loaded word that's got, you know, a lot of different things. Business sustainability, environmental sustainability. I'll try to quickly talk on a couple of, the items that make it up. If you look at it, why have they gone, trying to understand why. I think sometimes to move forward, and how do you plan moving forward, you got to look back and say, why have systems started and failed? Why have they not worked? I can tell you that the City of New York, EDC, from our perspective, now we have really two customers here. The customers who are going to ride the system and the city. You know, we need to make sure that we, fulfill our obligations and meet the city's expectations. But I do think there's a lot of alignment that the city is moving really fast to serve, as you mentioned, the largest ferry expansion in New York history. This isn't just yet another boat or we're putting one toe in the water here. This is the city and EDC really jumping in, with both feet committed to a system. So you already have a strong partner, a strong, entity that's going to help support make that sustainable, as it isn't just yet another pilot program. But I think that the long term is it has to work for the people who are going to be riding it, all right? And I think that community engagement, the talking, the landings doesn't need to be here, it needs to be here. You know, those are critical pieces into developing a system that will work. I think from our perspective as the operator, it's about the marketing. It's about making sure that it meets people's needs. Now, once the system and the landings are in place and they're covered and they're accessible, making sure that then the system meets people's needs. Getting around New York, it's one of the, it's an amazing thing, but it's also a struggle at times, right? Especially if you're in some of these areas that the ferries are not going to be going to. You mentioned the students with an opportunity can't get into the city accessibly or easily. We're going to change people's lives. And I think once you do that, and you do it in an affordable way, with a strong partnership, with a strong operator, those are the combination of things, the engagement with the community, the commitment from the city, those combinations of letting people focus in the areas that they do well. You know, the city focus in its area, the community engagement focus in its area, and then the operator focus in the area where it does well. Those pieces come together is what's going to allow us to have a sustainable business. And as it turns to the environmental side, I think it's, again, the commitment of the city, the commitment of an operator to do the things, to push the envelope, to try to innovate and create an environmentally sustainable system as well.
Yeah. Okay. Nope. All right. So I think we've all spoken at length, and now we'll have our Q&A.
Yep.
Okay, so are we taking questions directly for the audience or through through here?
You can't ask a question.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't have my email. I couldn't get to your server, so I can't send a question now.
I didn't either.
Well, we can start knocking a few off, and then maybe we'll drop
it.
I think we have a...
Totally.
We've got 10 or 15 minutes, so we can go through. Easy ones. Will bikes be allowed on the ferry? Yeah, bikes are allowed on the ferry. Ken was talking about it. There is a fee for bikes. There's a $1 fee for bicycles on the ferry. And there's a cap. I have to remember exactly what it was so that you're not, if you're a regular rider, you're not paying every single time. But that one's easy.
I think Cameron's point about marketing and taking a more global perspective, which of course Hornblower has, what's worked in other cities with marketing community outreach? What hasn't?
I mean, I think there's it's not a silver bullet, right? I think it's understanding your profiles here in New York. We carry millions of passengers, so it's understanding the demographics and the people to be able to reach them in a medium that's appropriate, that's timely, that's, you know, I think that's a big component to it. And at the end of the day, word of mouth, you know, is another critical aspect. And that comes back to the quality, the reliability of the service as well. So not one thing, but you know, definitely a combination. Yeah.
And how can you know, because this is a citywide ferry system, and you're actually you have this rallying point to bring together a lot of communities that have a lot in common. How can this become a point of connection, not just between the city and communities, but between you know among waterfront communities? It like, gets at this first question: how can the stakeholders in different neighborhoods engage with one another?
I think one of the interesting things we're starting to learn on the Easter ferry, just as we look at ridership patterns and as we talk to people, we have about two-thirds our commuters on the existing Easter ferry, and they're not all going to Midtown and Lower Manhattan. I mean, there are people who are going to Long Island City, there are people who are going to North Williamsburg, and so we're seeing those dynamics change, and so there are these connections that's not strictly looking and saying that Queens and Brooklyn are residents and they work in Midtown and Lower Manhattan and that's the end of the story. It's a very different kind of demographic that we're learning about, and as soon as we create these sort of like portals, you can call them, between these communities, I think you'll start to see what those other connections are. Yeah. It's hard to predict. I mean, I certainly don't know each community as well as I do my own, and I don't know each community and sort of what it's sort of still has a need for that it doesn't, that it, that if you only connected it this way, suddenly you say, oh, that's now this real big open opportunity. Yeah. So we'll see.
Yeah, and I think just one thing, and then maybe you can't go out there, I just think on the statement of, you know, engagement, you know, our goal is by allowing people to go to citywideferry.nyc to start that conversation. Give us your feedback as the site evolves. It will also be, you know, it's real, you know, communication, and we'll have real people being able to engage and answer feedback, collect that information, and you know, we'll be able to communicate the actions that we're taking and the stuff that we're working on with the city in that process. So, yeah.
I think we can probably start taking questions in the audience. Pamela?
Yeah. Hi.
Next.
One of the portals that you may consider is, I've worked with Ina and I work with Elijah, is that a community like Coney Island, we've looked at the studies and as far as the transportation, we've got all of that covered, you know, we've got the rides, we've got the amphitheater, we can really keep a ferry going. But one of the most important things to the residents is after Sandy, we have no egress. We have no way of getting off of this peninsula. I don't know if you realize it's only 3 blocks wide. You have Neptune, Mermaid, and Surf. And either way, one more block, you're in the water. We have over 50,000 residents in addition to all of the visitors. And we have no way of getting off this peninsula in case of an emergency or even getting any supplies or help or anything. The reason why I'm bringing this up because we have to learn from some of the mistakes that happened during Sandy. It should never happen again. We should build everything a little better and take in consideration. We have a lot of disabled people, wheelchairs, they had to leave them. They were abandoned because there was no way of getting them off of this peninsula. I think the city buses can handle maybe one or two wheelchairs, and that's it. Kind of take that in consideration as one of your portals.
Sure, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay.
Joe?
The thing is ridership. Ridership is everything. No one, on any question here, anything you've talked about is ridership. Reverse tourism. How do we get reverse tourism so we can build up numbers on off hours? I mean, when C Street was doing it, we were trying to work something out with the restaurants and the movies, also school trips. This is why I showed up at every meeting and said we got to change the schedule, 5:30, 6:30, 7:30, and EDC refuses to do it. the same thing is maybe we have to adjust a run during the afternoon because I contacted the schools. I live in Rockwell. And they have to be back by a certain period of time. Even if we have to miss a run, this would increase ridership. The other thing too is Rockaway eventually is going to take off because you can actually get a two-bedroom apartment in Rockaway right now for $1,700. Once that gets out, it's going to be overwhelmed. The other thing you didn't talk about is the airports. I don't see the airports on the map. 10 million people go from Kennedy. 7 million people go from that. That could be the subsidy for half-hour ferry service down the East River, and you always leave it out. And I like the form here. Every suggestion that came out of Rockaway, I don't think you took one of them. On schedule, on anything.
Maybe I could just chime in because we weren't a part of all the planning process, so we won't go to that stuff. But I can say the city picked the operator that carries more students than any other private ferry company.
I'm trying to get the numbers up.
Students
from Rockaway, they have to be back by 3 o'clock, so we have to adjust the schedule. Okay. I'm not talking about how many you carry.
Yeah, but
I'm trying to get the numbers for Rockaway built up.
Sure, and I think where I was going is you've got an operator that is highly focused and experienced at targeting different segments, right? We carry more international riders than any other private ferry operator, more students. We have more packages and partnerships, and so I think what you're finding here is that, I think EDC did answer it, that we do see a process that will be adaptive over time, and you have an operator that is also going to help support that process and is also highly skilled at covering the gambit of riders, whether it's morning commuters, the midday gap between tourists to the evening commuters, and that's through partnerships, it's through school group engagement and working with schools, it's working with local businesses. To ensure that we're meeting the needs of those businesses. And so, I don't think we can answer all your questions in terms of the timing today, but in terms of the operator, they did hear you on picking an operator to help work with the community to get engagement with all the different groups and constituents. Agree? Yep.
Hi, ma'am, since you weren't able to
mention. Thank you very much. Your draft environmental impact analysis indicates that you will, in fact, exceed air emission limits in Lower Manhattan. Right now, Lower Manhattan has the fourth worst air quality in the entire city. Exceedances is a nice word. Its synonym is violation. So I was wondering, And by the way, probably the only Republican in the group is asking about the air emissions. So I was wondering, in light of all of this, your environmental impact analysis process runs in parallel, obviously, with many of these engagement strategies. So what's your plan to take the now divulged problems with the process and actually go back and tell those directly to those affected communities so they can understand what you're going to do about that? And are you going to talk to the regulators about that so that you're not violating the law?
Sure, let me start and then I'll give it to Kim. So certainly part of the draft EIS and the environmental impact statement is absolutely what you're talking about. It's a disclosure document. The idea is to look at the projects that we're pursuing and to disclose to the public what's happening with all of these projects. And it's looking at often this reasonable worst case scenario, which for us, before we had picked Hornblower, certainly involved us having to fill in certain things and understand our best guess at what the sort of worst case scenario was. And so that's what you're reading about, is this reasonable worst case scenario. And yes, there was an identified impact that came out through that study. But one of the things that's sort of not captured as well is the real tangible elements that come from having exactly what Kim is talking about, an operator to solve for things that are not always captured. So for example, having vessels that have a much slicker way through the water. I'll let Kim go through these. The ways to save fuel that are not necessarily tied directly to the exact modeling that is shown there. Also, I'd like to just say that, it's certainly not something that's, suddenly divulged and not trying to hide anything. This was actually a document that's been circulated very broadly and emailed out to everyone in our contact list, all of the community groups that we've been working with, a lot of elected officials, as well as all of our peer city agencies, and the Mayor's Office of Sustainability, which manages the EIS. So definitely as many steps as we can to sort of get the word out there. But let me let Kim talk a little bit about what we are, in fact, doing to make sure that even though there are the elements part of the DEIS, that we're able to combat them with really great progress.
You know, I think it's important to also bring up that the ferries isn't the piece that was the straw that broke the camel's back either, right? The city's doing a lot of things and has other programs and abatement programs in place, whether it's boiler replacements and other systems to help mitigate emissions as a whole. Ferries is one part of that. Transportation is one part of that. You know, not being able to answer on all the programs that the city has in place, you know, I can answer just about what Hornblower is doing specifically. And I think that goes into the vessel design to start. The best way to reduce emissions is by not burning fuel in the first place. And so having the most fuel-efficient vessel, engines that are the most fuel-efficient and emissions-reducing that you can buy is a critical key component to that. And then training with the crew. You know, modification or timeliness of the schedule so you're not wasting fuel unnecessarily. As an organization as a whole, our owner actually started as an environmental engineer. And before he got into this business, that was his background, was in actually emissions control systems for factories in the 70s when America started regulating factories. And so we've always had part of our culture, that component, and we do look forward to being able to bring that that vision, that commitment to environmental sustainability. It was into the hybrid boats we've created, it was into the other emission reduction systems that we've developed to this project in conjunction with the city as well, as the time, as the routes, as the budgets allow.
So you're saying the DEIS did not analyze this project using the operational parameters that you plan to use, that somehow what you're going to do when you actually drive the ferries around is different from the inputs you put in the EIS?
The EIS has been where we were, our best estimate of everything, and what we're trying to say is that that is the reasonable worst case scenario. That's our starting point, and everything from there is what we're working very closely with Cam and Hornblower to advance to get better from there. So yeah, that we have to disclose and look at what that worst case is, and this is where the rubber meets the road on our ability to actually do better than that.
And so as you said, it was before the operator was selected.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ma'am? Yes.
Sure. My name is Katie. I'm a reporter with DNA Info. I know Alicia Glenn had said a few months ago that the ferry would launch June 2017, which the city then dialed back completely, I guess, when other people were writing about it. So I guess the answer to the question that everyone probably has is, when can we all expect the ferry to launch? Because it's coming up on almost a year now, I guess, or even less than that, when it can launch. And the city's remained very vague about the start date. I guess you said the boats don't even have a contract yet for the boats, if I understand that correctly. So when can people expect to actually start riding on the boats?
Sure. So we continue to say early summer of 17, certainly because we don't want to create an expectation that we can't manage. We are sure that we're going to hit early summer. I don't want to give a date and then be 3 days later. So certainly at this juncture, that's continuing where we are right now. So.
And we support that.
You support that?
Me too.
Yeah.
We'll take one more question because we're coming up on 8 o'clock.
It's a question for James. And coming back to Lower Manhattan, related to the East River ferries, there was a study that the EDC put out last year regarding the Brooklyn Bridge beach, whether it should be open to the public, just the beach under the Brooklyn Bridge on the Manhattan side. And the EDC said no, despite getting $5 million funding. Lower Manhattan Community Board 1 said yes, they want the beach open, and they criticized the study. And there's been no response. So what is the process in the EDC when a community board critiques an EDC study and passes a resolution saying we disagree? What happens next? Because what's happened next is nothing.
Sure. So let me start by saying I was not involved, and I actually don't know about the specifics, of what you're talking about. It's certainly our goal at EDC to be engaging communities along the way. We take very seriously input from community boards. As I had mentioned, we have an entire group that's strictly focused on meeting with community relations. And so they are an integral part of our projects and our planning. I think I've shown tonight sort of what we're looking forward to is this model of really good back and forth and real engagement. Certainly can't speak to each and every project, so unfortunately I don't know the specific answer.
Community board want to get a formal response from the EDC over their resolution criticizing the EDC study?
You know, without knowing the detail, I'm sorry, I don't know that this is the right forum for it, but without knowing the detail, I can't really respond to it.
We're going to have a special forum on EDC responses to community requests.
That's going to be a bestseller.
It will be. I'm sorry, ma'am, I know these guys aren't going to run, sprint to the elevator, but they will have to leave. but I think that you can pigeonhole him for a quick question or two before we break, but we have to be polite to our hosts and break at 8 o'clock. I want to have a big round of applause for this incredible panel. Now, that question that we sort of started answering before, stakeholders in other neighborhoods, and I looked at Lisa too, and maybe I'll pigeonhole you. Other community movements that we look locally, but there's same things happening all over. And we have an idea called the Citywide Ferry Committees that we talk, like to establish in each neighborhood to support the work we're going to try to knit those people together. So the folks in Soundview know what the folks in Rockaway are thinking, in Red Hook, etc. They trade ideas. So that's and I think that happens in other ideas and other realms. So. I'm going to focus on that question and try and answer it better ourselves through the Waterfront Alliance. But again, thank you all. I hope to see every single one of you at the conference in 8 short days. And we appreciate your coming to the deep dive. And we appreciate Cornell again for hosting us. And again, the panel.